हेलो हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, कम ऑन, गुड आफ्टरनून टू एवरीबडी, कम एंड जॉइन. आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट योर 12th क्लास सेकंड चैप्टर बायोलॉजी पार्ट टू कंटिन्यूएशन. मैसेल्फ जलजा सजीव in front of you. Yesterday, due to some technical problem, some problem in the power supply, I was unable to complete this session. So today I will continue the same session. I hope you all will enjoy. Here are the different content areas. Today we will cover first development of female gametophyte, pollination, different types of pollination, different agents needed for pollination, adaptations or characters of different types of flowers, like entomophilous flowers, anemophilous flowers, and characters of hydrophilous flowers. So these are the different content area that we will cover today. First, here you will watch a wonderful video which will help you to recollect yesterday's concepts clearly. So here you can see the pistil, carpel with ovule, here you can see the placenta where the ovule is attached. Now the detailed structure of an ovule. Can you explain or can you analyze, identify what is the type of ovule? This is an anatropous ovule. Here you can watch the remaining aspects. See, these are the integuments, the protective covering. Two integuments, outer and inner integuments. Now here you can see the nucellus. Funicle you can see here, stalk of the ovule attaches with the point hilum on the body of the ovule. Chalasa, that is the end opposite to the micropyle. Here you can see the micropyle also. Nucellous tissues inside. The nucellous tissues you can see here. The detailed structure, parenchymatous cells, homogeneous cells, diploid, end structure, ploidy, micropyle, the opening that you can see here, produced by the integuments. And this is the megaspore mother cell. Now see that it divides and produces four haploid megaspores. A single megaspore mother cell developed from the nucellus at the micropylar end divides by meiosis and produces four haploid megaspores. And you can see these four megaspores, and out of these four megaspores only one becomes functional. The other three will degenerate. The other three lies in the micropylar end that will degenerate, and only one basal chalazal megaspore that will become functional. And now that single functional haploid megaspore develops into an embryo sac. Its single nucleus divides three times, produces eight nuclei. Which division? Mitosis. Now these eight nuclei present in the embryo sac, they will move to different poles. You can see here, three nuclei reaches the micropylar site, and the other three that will be reaching the chalazal end, and two nuclei are seen at the center. So in an embryo sac, you can see total eight nuclei, three at the micropylar end, three at the chalazal end, and two at the center. These polar nuclei seen at the center will fuse and forms secondary nucleus, or we can say it as secondary fusion nucleus. Each one is haploid. It unites together and forms a diploid secondary fusion nucleus. Thus, you can see egg apparatus with one egg and two synergids, two polar nuclei and three antipodals. Here you can see the synergids. So see the nuclei, how they are arranged, orienting. And why we will call these central two nuclei as polar nuclei? Because they came from the poles, opposite poles. One nucleus entered into the center of the ovule. So they are known as polar nuclei. So this is a recollection of the previous points. Now we will go to the next concept. The actual content area for today's session, that is development of female gametophyte and pollination, different types of pollination and different agents and the characters or adaptations of each type of flowers. The first one, that is development of female gametophyte. You know, female gametophyte means embryo sac, female gamete bearing structure. That is why it is known as female gametophyte. So female gamete is seen in the embryo sac. So it is known as, the embryo sac is known as female gametophyte. You have already observed this formation of embryo sac in this video. Out of the four megaspores, only one megaspore will remain as functional one. and that single functional megaspore with a haploid nucleus and single nucleus that will act as the first cell in the formation of this embryo sac or female gametophyte. So its single haploid nucleus, it divides by mitosis 3 times, and hence it produces 8 nuclei. The single haploid nucleus, when it divides by mitosis, first we will get 2 nuclei, then again it will divide, so 4 nuclei. Then after the third mitotic division, the 4 nuclei becomes 8. So 8 nuclei are formed inside a embryo sac. Now what are these different nuclei? So here you can see at the micropylar end, see this diagram, you can see a group of 3 cells, and this group of 3 cells we will call it as egg apparatus. So your question, what are the different components present in the egg apparatus? So your answer is, it consists of 2 synergids. You can see here in this diagram, 2 synergids and 1 large egg cell. Egg cell is comparatively larger than the synergids. So these 3 cells, 1 egg cell and 2 synergids, together forms the egg apparatus. And it is seen at which end of this embryo sac? That is seen at the micropylar region of the ovule or the embryo sac. Now, on the other end, which is this end? Yes, the end or the portion seen opposite to the micropyle, that is called as chalaza, chalazal end. And in this chalazal end, you can see 3 nuclei. And what are these 3 nuclei? They are called as antipodals. 3 antipodals. Each cell, each nucleus, that is haploid. Now, at the center here, you can see 2 nuclei. Out of these 2 nuclei, 1 came from the chalazal end and 1 came from the micropylar end. So, since both these nuclei are came to the center, or it reaches the center from opposite poles, so it is known as polar nuclei. Now, after some duration, these polar nuclei will fuse and form secondary fusion nucleus. So these are the different nuclei. Now here you can see, so after some period of time, each of these nucleus that will be surrounded by little bit of cytoplasm and membrane, it forms a cell. So here in the antipodal, here in this chalazal region, you can see 3 cells, 3 antipodal cells. And in this micropylar region, you can see 3 cells. What are those 3 cells? 2 synergid cells and 1 egg cell. And here you can see 1 particular cell only. These are the nuclei, not the cell. And the cell, this entire green area, that is clearly visible in this diagram. And this particular cell, this is a single cell. And this single cell, in which the polar nuclei are seen, and this cell is known as, this cell is known as central cell. Very important question for your examination. 1 more question. Name the cell in which polar nuclei are seen. So your answer is central cell. So, when we are counting the number of cells, how many cells are there in a mature embryo sac? Another important question. How many cells are present in a mature embryo sac? Can anybody say the answer? Yes, 3 cells here and 3 cells here on the chalazal end and 1 single central cell. So, how many? 3 plus 3 and 1. That means 7 cells. So, in a mature embryo sac, how many cells and how many nuclei are present? 1 mark question for your board examination. 8 nuclei and 7 cells. What are the 8 nuclei? Listen carefully. 3 nucleus seen at the micropylar region. Then 2 nuclei at the center. 3 nuclei at the chalazal end. So 8 nuclei. But considering the number of cells, 3 cells end, 3 cells at the chalazal end, and 2 cells at the 1 cell at the center. So it becomes 3 plus 3 plus 1, that is 7 cells. So a mature embryo sac contains 7 cells and 8 nuclei. Here you can see the same aspect, how that single cell, single megaspore divides and transforms into a mature embryo sac. See the diagram. Single functional megaspore, its nucleus divides by mitosis and forms 2 nuclei. Again divides, 4, once again divides, 8. These 8 nuclei are arranged and forms 8 nucleated embryo sac with 7 cells. So this type of an embryo sac formation, that is known as monosporic embryo sac formation. Why it is known as monosporic embryo sac formation? Because only one functional megaspore is involved in the formation of this embryo sac. So it is known as monosporic formation of embryo sac. And this type of embryo sac formation that is commonly seen in a typical plant, that is called as polygonum plant. So this type of embryo sac formation, monosporic embryo sac formation, is also known as polygonum type of embryo sac formation. This is an additional information for you. And next, here you can see the concept filiform apparatus. So what is this filiform apparatus? Another important question for your exam. Filiform apparatus. You see the diagram clearly. Here at the base of these synergids, you can see some finger-like structures. Some special cellular thickenings. So these special cellular thickenings that is seen at the base of the synergids, that is called as filiform apparatus. Now what is the function? Why it is needed? So it helps in the entry of the pollen tube into the ovule. That means pollen tube carrying the male gamete will enter through this micropyle and enter into this embryo sac through this one of the synergid. So the entry of the pollen tube into the embryo sac is guided by this filiform apparatus. That is the function of filiform apparatus. Very important for your exam. Now, here you can again see these different cells, 7 different cells present in a mature embryo sac. 8 nuclei and 7 celled condition. Cell and 2 synergids together forms what? Apparatus. Then 1 central cell. This central cell is the polar nuclei. Then 3 antipodals. So altogether in a mature embryo sac you can see 7 cells and 8 nuclei. Now we are going to the next concept, that is pollination. See here a simple animation is of you. What is going on here? The pollen grains, that is on the stigma of the plant, of the flower. Mature pollen grains, anther dehies, and the pollen grains are falling on the stigmatic piece of the flower, the same flower. So here, transfer of what? Pollen grains. Transfer of pollen grains from to stigma. So this phenomenon, that is called as pollination. Now, what are the types of pollination? There are different types. So first one is self-pollination. Self-pollination, the name is autogamy. Auto means self. Gamy means fusion. So here self-pollination or autogamy. Here going on is pollen grains that are falling on the stigma of the same flower. So it is known as self-pollination. Transfer of pollen grains from to stigma of the same flower. This phenomenon, that is called as self-pollination or autogamy. Now, what are the devices that helps in self-pollination? If there is self-pollination, what are the characters or conditions or devices must be there in order to favor that self-pollination or autogamy? So one is these anther as well as the pistil. These two both should mature simultaneously. Same time may mature hona chahiye, anther as well as pistil. Anther and the stigma. Anthers as well as the stigma that must lie close to each other. There occurs pollination. And the third condition is synchronous release. By synchronous release, same time pe pollen grains release hona chahiye aur us samay pe stigma must be ready for receiving the pollen grains. So synchronous release of the pollen grain and stigma receptive. Then the flowers must be cleistogamous flowers. Yet another condition, there are different types of flowers. One flower, that is cleistogamous. And in cleistogamous flowers, there occurs only autogamy. And such a type of a flowers, example, Oxalis, Camelina, Viola, or otherwise known as common pansy. So we will see in detail what is this cleistogamous flower or what are the different types of flowers that we will deal in this same session. Now, what are the advantages of autogamy? Autogamy ka advantages, relevance, merits, importance, role. So what is it? One is chance of pollination is more. There is assurance for pollination. When there is assurance for pollination, there is assurance for fertilization and assurance for seed set also. Then if a continuous pollination, self-pollination takes place, characters get fixed. So the plants will be transformed into these homozygous plants. Characters will be fixed. No change in the characters. Then no need for the production of large number of pollen grains. Because it is falling on the same flower, it is not traveling for a long distance. So no need for the production of large number of pollen grains. Then such plants, there is no need for any nectar formation or no need for any pollinating agents or even no need for any scent production, any fragrance. Then what are the disadvantages? Of course, there are disadvantages also. You know, variation of a character is an essential aspect for increasing the hybrid vigor, productivity and all. And even it leads to evolution of characters. So in this case, since there occurs continuous pollination, plants will be gradually converted into homozygous plants and the characters get fixed. Characters will not change. So no chance for variation. So no chance for evolution. And there occurs deterioration of a character. Means the hybrid vigor, strength, productivity, yield, all these will decreases. So this is the disadvantage of this autogamy. Now, types of flowers. I have already told you there are different types of flowers on opening. Whether the flower will open out or it remain closed. So based on that, we can divide flowers into two categories. First one, that is chasmogam. Here in the screen, you can see two flowers. One is melon and the other is sunflower. These two flowers, this is an example I have given you. There are so many such flowers. So here the flower is fully open. After maturity, the flower bud will open and it exposes its stamen as well as stigma. So it the stamen and stigma are exposed in these type of flowers and flowers get open. So such type of flowers, they are known as chasmogamous flowers. Clear? Example, most of the flowers you might have seen only these chasmogamous flowers. Hibiscus, rose, dahlia, melon, sunflower, like that. Now, second category of is cleistogamous flower. Here you can see in the screen on the right top, here you can see the flower. Flowers are closed. For a very time, it will remain as closed only. It will not open. The flowers will not open and it will never expose its stamen or stigma. So such a type of a flower, there is no chance of any cross-pollination because the stamens are not exposed and the stigmatic surface is not exposed. So there is no chance for cross-pollination. So what is the type of pollination? Only autogamy, self-pollination. So flowers that will not open, such flowers are called as cleistogamous flowers or closed flowers. Very important question for your exam. What are the two types of flowers produced by common pansy or viola or camelina or oxalis? Very important question. So these plants, oxalis, viola, or common name is common pansies and camelina. So these plants, they produce two types of flowers. What are the two types of flowers? Cleistogamous flower as well as chasmogamous flowers. Both the types of flowers are produced by these plants. Very important question. What is meant by cleistogamous flower and What is meant by Chasmogyamus flower? Cleistogamous means the flower will remain closed. Very easy to link this concept. See in the screen. Cleistogamous begins with CL. Closed begins with CL. So, cleist means which flower? Closed flowers. Closed flowers means will not open at all. So, when the flowers are not open, then its stigma and style will not be exposed to air. So, in such a case, there occurs only which pollination? Yes, self-pollination or autogamy. So, the other type of flower is Chasmogyamous flower. So, this is the special character of these plants. These three plants, like that there are so many plants. But in your textbook, is very important aspect mentioned. And every year, there will be question from this concept. Now, Jeytunogamy. What is Jeytunogamy? Very important aspect you see here. Here there is a butterfly. It is taking nectar. And when it tries to collect the nectar, as well as these pollen, the pollen grains will stick on its legs. It will move one flower to the other. So, pollen grains are transferring from one flower to the other. So, this phenomenon that is called as Jeytunogamy. Here you see, from one flower, the honeybee is moving to another flower. Of which plant? Same plant or a different plant? Of a same plant. So, this phenomenon, it is known as Jeytunogamy. That means transfer of what? Pollen grains. Transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of another flower but belongs to same plant. So it is known as Jeytunogamy. Clear? So functionally it is equivalent to what? Cross pollination. But regarding the genes, genetically it will be self-pollination. So, functionally cross-pollination and genetically it is autogamy or self-pollination. Name the mechanism. That is the question. So, your answer is Jeytunogamy. Clear? Now, here you can see a wonderful animation that is explaining your concept clearly. Here, the mechanism is Xenogamy. That means, here the butterfly that is moving from one flower to the other plant to the other plant. Here, you can see on the left side, these honey are moving from to the but belonging to two different plants. There are two different plants, plant 1, plant 2 belong to same species and moving from one plant to the other, from one flower to the other flower belonging to the. Here you can see the animation, the butterfly is moving from flower 1 belongs to plant 1 and it moves to flower 2 belongs to plant 2. So, this movement, this type of a transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of different flower belonging to different plant of the same species. It is called as Xenogamy. Here, at another aspect correlation I will give you. See the spelling Xenogamy. Start with which letter? X in mass indicates what? Cross. So, this is which pollination? cross pollination. Clear? Begins with X. In mass it appears as into cross. So that means which pollination? Cross pollination. So another term for cross pollination is allogamy. Allo means different. Different gametes will be fusing and it belongs to. So allogamy. Clear? So functionally as well as genetically, this is what? Cross pollination. Functionally as well as genetically, this is equivalent to a cross pollination. So functionally and genetically, cross pollination. What term will you give? Your answer is xenogamy. Name, allogamy. Now, what are the devices, characters or adaptations that favors xenogamy or cross pollination in a flower? Very important question, 3 mark for your board examination. First concept is unisexual flower. Unisexual flower means uni means single. That flower possesses only one sex. So that means it may be either a male flower or it may be a female flower. So in such cases, there occurs only cross pollination. And second is dioecious condition. You know, dye means two. There are two separate plants. One plant is male and the other plant is female. So one plant is male means it is only male flowers carrying the pollen grains, carrying the anther, carrying the stamen. And the other one is female plant. It possesses only female sex organ. So in that, so there occurs only which pollination? Cross pollination or xenogamy. Typical example of a dioecious condition, there are certain plants, date palms and papaya. So already we have learned these concepts in the first chapter. Now, pollen release and stigma receptivity. If these two are at the same time, then there occurs self-pollination, but not be synchronized. Eki samayipe pollen grain release or stigma receptivity nahi honi chahiye. So pollen release and stigma receptivity that are taking place simultaneously. Synchronized means simultaneously. So different the orientation of anther and stigma in a flower. That means sometimes the anther is seen below the stigma. So the pollen grains cannot reach the stigmatic surface. For stigma. Then the fifth point is self-incompatibility. A very important short question also, this aspect. Self-incompatibility. Self means the same. Incompatible means not matching. Here means inability of a pollen grain of a single plant, of the same plant, to fertilize the ovules of the same plant. Same plant ka pollen grain, agar same plant ka stigmatic surface mein gaya, to it will not germinate. Suppose agar germinate ho gaya, to wo pollen grains grow nahi karega. It can't reach the ovule. Jab tak ovule pe nahi aayega, to it can't make any fertilization. So inability of the pollen grain to fertilize the ovules of the same plant. So that is what is called as self-incompatibility. Very important question. And a typical plant that shows self-incompatibility, that is Nicotiana tubacum. What is this plant? Yes, tobacco plant. So here you can see the sixth character, that is male sterility. What is male sterility? That means the male plant is sterile. That means not able to produce pollen grains. So such stamens, sterile stamens, what term we will give for the sterile stamens? Anybody else? Yes, you can see here minode. See in your screen on the left side top corner, you can start with sterile stamens. So such sterile stamens are known as staminode. If it is a sterile, we'll say pistillode. Od means like. O-D-E, od here means like. So staminode means stamen like, not the exact stamens. They are sterile, not able to produce the stamen, this pollen grain. Then next aspect here is the seventh point that favors cross pollination, that is heterostyly. Hetero means different. Here on the right side of your screen, you can see the diagram. Heterostyly means different types of a style. You see gynecium, it is very long, the carpel, it is very long, very tall, long one. And see the anther, it is just the size of the carpel. And here on the other diagram, you can see a small or a small carpel. So different, it is called as heterostyly. And see the pollen, this anther, it is very low. So this type of a phenomenon, different types of and the length of the gynecium, that is you can see here it is different. So that phenomenon is called as heterostyly. In one the style is very short and the other one is long. So hetero means different types of style you can see in a flower. So this type of a heterostyly, that is shown by plant, for example primula and linum. Primula you can see here on the left side bottom, and linum flower you can see here on the top. You might have seen this type of flowers in your school garden, I think. So here the length of the style as well the stamen, that is different in different flowers. Then the eighth point that favors the cross pollination is hercogamy. It is a very important term, a new term for your exam. In your textbook it is not mentioned, but it is an additional knowledge for PMD exams and all. So the term is hercogamy. What is this hercogamy? So presence of some of mechanical barriers. Some physical mechanical barriers are seen on the stigmatic surface that prevents a self. So such a type of mechanical barriers present on the stigmatic surface, that is preventing self-pollination and favor pollination, cross pollination. So that is known as hercogamy. Such a type of hercogamy you can see very clearly in Calotropis flower. Have you seen this flower in your garden? Yes. Another flower that is known as Clerodendron. Here you see the all the stamens are after it is curved and it is going to at another direction. And here you can see the style, the guide, it is moving to yet another direction. So no chance of self-pollination, but only favoring what? Cross-pollination. Now, another important concept, another character that favors cross pollination is known as dichogamy. Now, dichogamy, pollen as well as the stigma, they are maturing at different times. Alag alag samay pe pollen mature hoga or stigma mature hoga. So that concept that is known as dichogamy. Di means two. So dichogamy means pollen as well as stigma is maturing at different times. And what are the different types of dichogamy? Very important question. One is protogyny. Proto means first. Gyne goes to gynecium. So protogyny means gynecium will mature first, mature earlier than the androecium. Which type of flowers you can see in Bajra and Aristotle? Here, these flowers you can see in your screen. See, Bajra flower you see. All these gynecium, that is pollen grains, or this anther, that will mature later only. So never, no chance of any self-pollination. Then this is the plant that is known as Aristolochia. Have you ever seen this type of flowers? Okay. Now, so here you can see protogyny. Gynecium is maturing first, and these anthers that will mature later only. Now, it's the other aspect, that is the opposite of this one, is protandry. The term is protandry. Pro means first. Andry refers to androecium. Androecium, the units are stamens. And these stamens, see here, this is which plant? Plant? Yes, maize plant. Good. So in maize plant, this androecium matures first. Later on, gynecium will mature. So this phenomenon, that is called as protandry. So it is also favoring which pollination? Cross pollination. Typical example, that is maize. Now, different pollinating agents. Agents that are needed for ensuring pollination, or agents that are needed for transferring pollen grains from anther to stigma of a flower. So these agents, we can classify it into two different types. Non-living agents. If it is a non-living agent, then we can name it as abiotic agents. A means absent. Abiotic means non-living. So non-living agents are known as abiotic agents. So what are the different abiotic agents? Wind and water. Then second one is biotic agents. Biotic agents means are the living organisms that helps in pollination. Now, we can some of these characters of abiotic, some of the characters of wind pollinated flowers. So here the agent is abiotic agent, that is wind. Wind is transferring the pollen grains from one plant to the other. So when wind is carrying, it can be carried to distant. So what are the adaptations, or what are the salient features, what are the characteristic features of a wind pollinated flower? Wind pollination is known as anemophily. Very important question. Wind pollination is known anemophily. See, it is here, anemophily. Now here in the on this in your screen, you can see the diagram of a wind pollination. See the cloud-like structure. These are pollen grains, dusty pollen grains. These are carried by the wind to different places. So this is which plant? This is Pinus plant. So what are the characters? First one, when wind carries light in weight, the pollen grains are light in weight, then it must be non-sticky and it must be dry. And sometimes it is winged also. Winged pollen grains are present in Pinus plants. So these winged pollen grains are carried by the wind. And moreover, when they are carried by wind, it has to be produced in large quantities. So they are produced, the pollen produced in large amount, large quantities to avoid the loss. Then all the stamens, that means the anther, that must be well exposed. Then only we can carry the pollen grains to different places. So stamens, that must be well exposed. And the anther, versatile anther. What is meant by versatile anther? That means the anther is freely swings in the air with the help of a connective. Just at the back of the anther, the connective, the filament is attached with a connective only at a particular point. So these anthers can swing freely in the air. So such type of an anther, mainly it is seen in this maize and all. In almost all the pot plants, you can see versatile anthers. So that versatile anthers, they help in anemophily. Then large stigma. Why there is the need for feathery stigma to trap the pollen grains? Stigma must be large so that it can trap or collect the pollen grains coming through the air. Then if the flowers are small, then all these flowers are arranged to form a group that is called as inflorescence. We call it as inflorescence. Last year also you have learned in your 11th class, inflorescence. So easy for trapping the pollen grains. Then yet another question for your examination is one more question. How many ovules will be there in anemophilous? Not on the question. How many ovules will be there in anemophilous flowers? Your answer is single ovule. You know, here I am correlating yet another question also. In the order Poales and family Poaceae, that means grass family, monocots, they are present only one ovule, basal ovule inside a carpel. Now, these pollen grains are carried by wind. So, what type of a flower it needs? Is there any need for any showy flower? No, not showy and not colored. Showy and colored flowers, brightly colored flowers are needed to attract the insects for pollination. But here, it is pollination. So, no need for any beautiful color. So, it is not at all showy. Now, no need for odors. Again, no need to attract the insects. No need for any fragrance and no nectar at all. So, these are the different characters of an anemophilous flower. Anemophilous flower means, yes, wind pollinated flowers. So, wind pollination in plants, that is known as anemophily. Here you can see at a plant, another is this plant, yes, maize. In which category it comes under? Monocot, dicot, kya hai ye? Monocot. So in this particular plant, there occurs which pollination? Wind pollination, anemophily. And in most of these monocots, mainly grasses, they are coming under the order family Poaceae, P-O-A-C-E-A-E. In poies, A or poiels or in grasses or in monocots, what is the type of pollination seen in flowers? Answer is wind pollination. Here at another important one more question, that is this particular, have you seen in this diagram? This particular part, this is known as tussles. And these tussles present in the corn cob. What is this? Morphologically, which structure the tussles in corn cob? One mark question for your board exam. It is stigma and the style. So, stigma and the style together constitute the tussle seen in the maize plant in its cob, corn cob. So now we are going to wind up the session. The assignment for today, note down the assignments. Remaining aspects we will see on the next class. First question is, draw a neat labeled diagram of an Anatropous ovule. Then, so this question is a very important 3-mark question. Asked as a part of your 5-mark question also. Very important question. Clearly you have to draw the diagram. Proper size and structure and proper labeling is needed. Then only you will get full mark. One question is, draw the labeled diagram of a mature embryo sac. You know, mature embryo sac contains 7 cells and 8 nuclei. Question. Third question, which part forms the tussles in corn cob? Every year the same question is coming, stigma and style. Mention the different adaptations in anemophilous. You write the question, anemophilous flower, because time is going to finish, so I will deal the content on the next class. You write the question, adaptations, anemophilous flowers. Then, explain megasporogenesis with the help of a neat labeled diagram. These are your assignments. Go through these contents, listen the video and learn all the concepts. Enjoy, stay at home, be safe, be positive and learn well. Thank you.